This family friend speaking on GMTV earlier says the family's frantic.
They've been looking themselves, they walked along the hedgerows and they've been out shouting, but there's nothing else they can do unless they get support from the police over there or the police here.
That's Jill Rennick. She told GMTV the shutters on the hotel room had been broken and the family believe their daughter's been taken.
Well, as you can imagine, as a mother, it's the worst thing for anybody to happen. She's been taken. She's been taken, that's all they know.
Before we start, I would like to point out why I have made yet another Madeleine McCann film. It is to expose the mainstream media and show to the widest possible audience that their purpose is not to find out facts, investigate stories, then truthfully report them. The mainstream media are used on a daily basis across all publications by an elite few for a range of nefarious purposes. Mainstream media publications are no more than information prostitutes who serve those with enough money or power to help them with their disgusting agendas. When watching this film, please make a note of any time a mainstream media publication is mentioned and note what their motive is for reporting their story. Note also the disgraceful level of access held throughout by Clarence Mitchell to be able to seemingly plant any story into any British newspaper he wished. We suspect that whenever any news item has been written which includes quotes or opinions from a friend of the McCanns, this friend is always, in fact, the media spin doctor, Clarence Mitchell. In my first documentary about the reported disappearance of Madeleine McCann, I gave an overview of the case. I presented the evidence of the alerts provided by two cadaver dogs, which suggested that there had been a body in the McCann's apartment. I looked at how the McCann's reacted to these disturbing results, and I went on to take a detailed look at the assortment of highly controversial detective agencies and individuals, some of them criminals, who were supposedly employed to look for Madeleine. And in the final part of that film, I give details of how state security and intelligence agencies like MI5 and Special Branch and the government's top PR staff have been involved in this case from the start. In my second film, I explained the extraordinary story of how the two main figures thought to have been Madeleine's abductor, Tannerman and Smithman, were possibly fabrications to try to prove that there was an abductor, when, as my films have shown, there was no evidence whatsoever of one. I also showed how these highly questionable sightings were possibly based on the description of a Polish man, Wojciech Krakowski, a strangely dressed Polish man who happens to be holidaying in the village of Praia do Luz in the same week as the McCanns. Just a few months after I released my film about Krakowski, the Sunday People ran a major article about him, suggesting that he might yet be able to help the police with their inquiries. Finally, I showed that a man stated on a BBC Crime Watch film to have come forward 6 years after the event to say it was him who had been carrying a child near the McCann's apartment the night she was reported missing was most likely also a fabrication, this time by the Metropolitan Police team supposed to be investigating the disappearance. I established in my first film that there was strong evidence that Madeleine had died in the McCann's apartment. In this film, I am going to try and establish when Madeleine might have died. In another film, I will explore what we can deduce about how she might have died. I am going to do this by working backwards through each of the claimed sightings of Madeleine during the days prior to the abduction claim, starting with the McCann's claim that they discovered Madeleine missing around 10 p.m. on Thursday the 3rd of May. I showed in my first film how there was a mass of contradictions and changes of story by the McCanns and their Tapper 7 friends about their claimed discovery that Madeleine was missing. We also saw how the children's bedroom appeared to have been arranged so as to promote the claim that Madeleine had been abducted and the room broken into by a stranger. The only evidence that they found Madeleine gone at 10 p.m. that night comes from the McCanns themselves. So let's now examine what was claimed to be the previous occasion on which someone else claimed to have seen Madeleine. This was a visit that the McCann's friend, Dr. Matthew Oldfield, claimed to have made to check on the children in the McCann's apartment at around 9:25 that evening. His alleged visit to check on the children in the McCann's apartment was reconstructed in a Channel 4 documentary shown on the 7th of May 2009. A documentary which merely reported the McCann's account of events and was therefore not in any sense independent. Matthew Oldfield spoke to both the Portuguese police and a year later to Leicestershire police, giving long, rambling, sometimes incoherent answers. So let's break down the essentials of what he told the police about his alleged 9:25 p.m. visit. He said that one or other of the group stood up every 15 minutes to go and check on the children. 2. He left with another doctor member of the group, Dr. Russell O'Brien, at 9:25 p.m. He was going to check on his own children. Dr. O'Brien, he says, was going to check on his two young girls, Ella and Evie. 3. He cannot explain why, on this occasion, the group departed from their normal procedure, with two of them leaving at the same time to check on the children. 4. Kate McCann had stood up to check on her children, but he offered to go instead. He told the Portuguese police that he didn't really know why he did that. 5. He went first of all to his own apartment, checked on his child, and then went to the apartment of his friend, Russell O'Brien. He doesn't explain why he went there. 6. When he got to his friend's apartment, he says that one of Russell O'Brien's daughters was crying. He told Oldfield that she was ill and had vomited. 7. He then went to the McCann's apartment, having allegedly been told by Kate McCann that when they set off to the tapas restaurant, she had deliberately left the patio door closed but unlocked, so that he would be able to just walk into the apartment to do his check. 8. He noticed the door to the children's room was half open, or, as he puts it more accurately, 50 degrees open. 9. He says he didn't actually go into the children's room. 10. He can't recall how near he got to the children's room. 11. He could see the children in their cots in the middle of the room, but not Madeleine, who was sleeping in a bed by the wall. 12. He says he recalls that the curtains, which he says were green in colour, were drawn closed. But the curtains were not green, as the photographs of the apartment clearly show. They were blue and white. 13. He wasn't sure if the window was open or not. 14. He can't recall if the shutters were open or closed. 15. He thought that there was more light in the children's room than in his own children's room that he had checked earlier. 16. He had the feeling that some light was coming from the outside, possibly because, he says, the blinds were partly up. 17. He is sure that when he passed by the McCann's window half an hour earlier, that the shutters had been raised. So let's now unpick that statement. Despite him claiming that members of the group were doing their own check every 15 minutes, which was later contradicted by the other members of the group who claimed they were checking every half hour on this occasion, for some unknown reason, two of them leave the table to do their checks together. It's important to emphasise at this point that going by the witness statements of the McCanns and all their friends, this was the very first time in the whole week that anyone had offered to check on another member's children. But even then, there are so many contradictions and inconsistencies about what the group all say about the events of that fateful evening that we really have to take any statement they make about those events with a very large pinch of salt. Oldfield must have taken a good look at the curtains as he notices they were closed. He also noticed that the apartment seemed light. Yet, when asked by the police what colour they were, he gets it wrong. He says green, when in fact they were blue and white. Let's now take a look at what Kate McCann says about this occasion. She states that as she got up to check on the children, Matthew Oldfield said to her, "I'll check on Maddie for you." Now, why would Oldfield say that? There were three children in the McCann's apartment. Why didn't he say, "I'll check on the children for you"? That alone suggests the accounts of both Matthew Oldfield and Kate McCann may be fabricated. Second, would the McCanns really have left their apartment unlocked? Very few people on holiday would leave their money, valuables, passport and credit cards in an unlocked apartment, never mind three children under four. And when we look in detail at what Oldfield does and doesn't say in his statement, it has the appearance of having been carefully crafted in order to back up Jane Tanner's claim that she saw the abductor at about 9:15 p.m. Jerry McCann says he finishes his alleged check on the children at 9:10 p.m. Jane Tanner says she saw an abductor at 9:15 p.m. Oldfield then backs up this scenario by speaking of the door being more open than before, claiming there was more light in the room and the blinds were partially up, etc. There is the addition of the very specific remark that the door was 50 degrees open. This remark shows every sign of having been made to tie in with the McCann statements that they left the door slightly ajar when they went down for dinner at 8:30 p.m. that evening. However, Jerry McCann also in his second statement to the Portuguese police on the 10th of May said that he did his check at 9:05 p.m. that evening, half an hour or so before Matthew Oldfield. He too found the door more open than before. In his first statement to the police on the 4th of May, Jerry McCann gave few details to the police about his 9:05 p.m. check, but now he gives these extra details. He noticed that the children's bedroom door was not ajar as he had left it, but halfway open, returning to place the door how he had already previously described. So he says the door was left ajar, they went down for dinner at 8:30 p.m, then he found it half open, 45 degrees, and then, as he leaves the apartment, he closes the door again, leaving it ajar. Jerry McCann seems in this statement to be trying to convince the police that someone may have entered the flat before his check. Then Matthew Oldfield comes along half an hour later and comes up with a tale that suggests that someone may have entered the apartment after Jerry's check. I suggest that they were all trying much too hard to show that an abduction really happened. In fact, this suggestion that someone had twice left the door open more than before, the first time at 45 degrees angle and the second time at 50 degrees angle, it seems then led Jerry McCann to make the astounding claim that the abductor could have been hiding in the apartment the entire time he did his alleged check at 9:05 p.m. This, for example, was how the Daily Telegraph reported this issue on the 21st of September 2007. Jerry's certain he was in bedroom with kidnapper. Jerry McCann is convinced his daughter's kidnapper was hiding behind a door in their holiday apartment as he checked on his sleeping children, according to a friend. But as he turned to leave the ground floor room, he noticed that a door, which he thought he had closed earlier, was slightly ajar. Agonizingly, he is now sure that standing behind this door was his four-year-old daughter's abductor, waiting to steal her from her bed in the Prideler's apartment. Jerry McCann believes there was certainly something odd, the friend said. The bedroom door was ajar when he got in and he thought, "That's strange." He went into the room, checked that Madeleine was still asleep in bed. She was, and he came out, closed the door. Initially, he thought she might have got up and gone to the toilet or gone to get a drink or something, but now he thinks that the abductor must have been in there, hiding. He believes the abductor came in, opened the door and didn't have time to close it before Mr. McCann arrived. After Mr. McCann checked the room at 9:05 p.m, Russell O'Brien offered to check the children. At 9:30 p.m, he listened at the door, but crucially did not go in. In another statement, Jerry McCann specifically said that he went into all four rooms of the apartment when he did his check at 9:05 p.m. He also volunteered the surprising information that he had spent an exceptionally long time in the loo. It's very hard to see how an abductor could have been hiding behind a door somewhere in the apartment for all of the 5 minutes Jerry McCann was doing his check. It's hard to work out what is supposed to have happened. We are told by Jerry that he turned to leave the ground floor room. Which room? He noticed that a door... So which door was that? Which he thought he had closed earlier. Which door had he closed earlier? Was slightly ajar. Jerry McCann adds, agonizingly, he is now sure that standing behind this door was his 4-year-old daughter's abductor, waiting to steal her from her bed. It seems that Jerry McCann is describing the children's bedroom and suggesting that the abductor was hiding in there. But it looks as though Jerry had by this time, September, forgotten what he told the Portuguese police back on the 10th of May. Then he had told them he noticed that the children's bedroom door was not ajar as he had left it, but halfway open. But now in this Telegraph article, he tells his friend, no doubt Clarence Mitchell once again, that he noticed that a door, which he thought he had closed earlier, was slightly ajar. So it seems that Jerry McCann has changed his evidence by first saying he left this door ajar, but now in this Telegraph article saying it was closed when he left it. It seems clear that it's the children's bedroom door that he's talking about, as the article goes on to say. The bedroom door was ajar when he got in and he thought, that's strange. He went into the room, checked that Madeleine was still asleep in bed. She was, and he came out, closed the door. He thinks that the abductor must have been in there hiding. All in all, there is a huge amount of talk about doors being open, closed, ajar, at this or that angle. All of these statements, both by Jerry McCann and Dr. Oldfield, seem designed to give the Portuguese police the impression that an abductor had been in and out of the McCann's apartment. Matthew Oldfield's claim that he didn't go into the children's room and only saw the twins in their cots but not Madeleine in her bed again seems tailor-made to fit with the other hints and suggestions that an abductor must have come in and out between Jerry McCann's last check at about 9:05 p.m, which I'll come on to in a moment, and Oldfield's check about 25 minutes later. There is therefore real cause for doubt as to whether this alleged check by Matthew Oldfield ever happened. Dr. Gonçalo Amaral, the original investigation coordinator, thought much the same in his book about the case, The Truth of the Lie. He wrote, Matthew Oldfield's statement happens to conveniently reinforce the hypothesis of an abduction and was meant to give weight to Jane Tanner's witness statement. Is there any proof that Madeleine was alive on Thursday the 3rd of May at 10 p.m. when Kate said she found Madeleine gone? We can say no, there is not. Or at 9:30 p.m. when Matthew Oldfield says he checked the McCann's apartment? No, there is not. So we now go back in time from Oldfield's claimed check at 9:25 p.m. to the visit Jerry McCann says he made to his apartment at 9:05 p.m. to 9:10 p.m. when he says he saw all three children sleeping happily. Can we accept this as proof that Madeleine was alive? This is a statement made by one of Madeleine's parents. We have already established that there is strong evidence that Madeleine may have died in the apartment. If Madeleine did die in the apartment, then Jerry McCann's statement that he saw Madeleine on this occasion is known in law as a self-serving statement. In other words, it is of no evidential value whatsoever in a court of law. It has not been and cannot be corroborated. So we can safely now amend our timeline as follows. Between around 7 p.m. and 8:30 p.m. on the 3rd of May, the McCanns say they were with all three children, feeding them, bathing them, reading stories to them and putting them down to sleep. There are several inconsistencies of their accounts of this period. For example, they gave three different versions of who read bedtime stories to the children, Kate, or Jerry, or both. But once again, whatever the McCanns say about this period of time, it is just another set of self-serving statements which cannot be corroborated by anyone else. So we have now gone back to 7 p.m. and still found no proof that Madeleine was alive. Now I come to the last time any third party is said to have seen the children, the alleged visit of David Payne to the McCann's apartment at around 6:30 to 7 p.m. on the 3rd of May. I dealt with this in great detail in part 2 of my film, The True Story of Madeleine McCann. As I went through the statements of both Dr. David Payne and Kate McCann, I was able to identify an unbelievable 20 clear contradictions between their different versions of what happened. Here is a list of them. Kate McCann said Payne never came into the apartment. Payne said he calmly walked in and stayed there at least several minutes. Kate says she was in the shower at the time and hastily put on a towel to answer a knock at the door. Payne mentions nothing of this. Besides, a long-standing close friendship with the McCanns is not a neutral witness, so we can dismiss this claimed sighting, as indeed Dr. Gonçalo Amaral also did in his book, and amend our timeline accordingly. Let's go back still further, another half hour, to yet another alleged proof that Madeleine was alive early that evening. Namely the claim that there was video footage from the Paraiso restaurant in Praia da Luz of Madeleine dancing with her father at about 5:30 p.m. to 6 p.m. on the 3rd of May. It was solemnly reproduced as a fact on a regular basis in our mainstream press. What is the truth? Video footage allegedly showing Jerry McCann dancing with Madeleine was produced by one Miguel Matias. Months later, it was established, then later admitted by him, to be a fake. Some years previously, Matias had been comprehensively exposed by a Portuguese newspaper journalist as a serial conman and fraudster who was known to the Portuguese police. So much for his bogus claim. So now we have gone back one stage further. Now we come on to an event which I'm going to deal with in some detail. That's because the senior detective who coordinated the original investigation into Madeleine's disappearance, Dr. Gonçalo Amaral, and his team believed that this event was sufficient proof that Madeleine was alive at this point. I am referring to a claim by the McCanns and one of the creche nannies that Madeleine was having high tea with them at around 5 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. on the day Madeleine was reported missing. This is how Dr. Amaral has put it in his book. The minor, Madeleine McCann, died inside apartment 5A of the Ocean Club in Praia da Luz on the night of the 3rd of May 2007. His senior detective inspector, Tavares de Almeida, wrote in his interim report, published 3 days after the McCanns were made suspects, "The last time that the child was seen outside of the group by someone who can prove they saw her was around 5:35 p.m. when the parents went to pick her up at the creche." One Madeleine McCann researcher was so convinced that Madeleine was alive at the high tea that she wrote, "According to all the evidence, Madeleine was alive when Kate signed her out of the tapas area at 5:30 p.m. on the 3rd of May 2007. So Madeleine must have gone missing sometime between 5:30 p.m. and 10 p.m. that day." I'm now going to look into detail at the two creche nannies who say they can prove they saw her. Creche nanny Charlotte Pennington and another creche nanny, Catriona or Cat Baker, and examine the conflicting statements made about the alleged high tea. First, Madeleine was supposedly looked after all that week by Catriona Cat Baker. Let's first of all look, with the help of Cat Baker, at what creches there were that week and where they were located. Here is what she said to the Portuguese police. "This type of childcare takes place in 4 different places according to the ages of the children. For children aged 4 months to 1 year, it is the Baby Club, which is close to the Ocean Club's main reception. For children aged 1 and 2 years, it is the Toddler Club, which is next to the Tapas restaurant. The McCann's twins, Amelie and Sean, were in the Toddler Club. For children aged 3 to 5, as Madeleine was, they are placed in the Mini Club, which is also close to the Ocean Club's main reception, along with the Baby Club. And finally, for children aged 6 to 9 years, and from 10 to 13 years, they attend the Junior Club, which is close to the Millennium Restaurant. Concerning the operating hours, Cat Baker tells us that there are 4 separate services. Mornings, 9 a.m. till 12:30 p.m. Afternoons, 2:30 p.m. till 5:30 p.m. The dining out service, 7:30 p.m. till 11:30 p.m. Children are watched in a room above the main Ocean Club 24-hour reception. There is no extra charge for this service, but parents must take and fetch their own children. And the babysitting service, 7:30 p.m. till 1 a.m. Children are watched in their own apartments. There is an extra charge for this service. In Kat Baker's statement, it says, when asked, the informant, Kat Baker, responds that it was always the parents who brought Madeleine and fetched her from the mini club. And Madeleine was in the so-called Lobsters mini club group. We now know that for whatever reason, the McCanns and their friends did not take up the offer of either of these evening childcare services. Kat Baker also refers to a high tea that she says was regularly taken at about 5:30 p.m. with children, creche nannies and parents all present. She says this was taken elsewhere, however, at the tapas bar. But there is real doubt about whether this alleged practice of high tea every day that week at 5:30 p.m. was a regular fixture at all. Other witnesses do not confirm it. According to what we have been told, on that holiday, the McCanns and their group took their children to their respective creches, one for the younger infants and toddlers, and the other for the older infants, at about 9 to 9:30 p.m., then took them out for lunch between 12:30 p.m. and 2:30 p.m., then put them back in their creches and arrived to collect them at about 5:30 p.m. As I've said, Madeleine was in a small creche group called Lobsters, the one run by Kat Baker. Let's now move on to see what Kate McCann herself says in her book Madeleine about the high tea on Thursday the 3rd of May. Having arranged for Jerry to meet the children, I opted to go for a run along the beach, where I spotted the rest of our holiday group. I remember being fleetingly disappointed that we hadn't known they were all heading for the beach, as it might have been nice to have joined them. I wondered whether Madeleine had been okay about staying behind in the mini-club, the Lobsters, when Russ and Jane had collected Ella. I had finished my run at 5:30 at the tapas area, where I found Madeleine and the twins already having their tea with Jerry. The others had decided to feed their kids at the beachside restaurant, the Paraiso. So what are we being asked to believe here? First, that Kate, because she had gone for a run at this time, had pre-arranged for Jerry McCann to walk to collect Madeleine from the Lobster Group at the Ocean Club 24-hour reception area, several minutes' walk away from their apartment, and then walk back with Madeleine to the place where the high tea was being held by the tapas bar. This must have happened all in good time for him to be sitting there happily eating high tea with the children at the tapas bar as Kate presumably jogged or walked back to join them all from the beach in her running gear after completing her run. Second, we're asked to believe that all the rest of their Tapa 7 group of friends had apparently decided not to bother about the high tea, instead taking all their children to the beach at the Paraiso restaurant for the afternoon. Kate claims she was a touch put out by this. Let's go on to consider what Kate says about what happened next.